Hey, welcome to Android Dialogues, where we have bite-sized conversations with people in the Android community. I'm Huynh Thuet Dao, and I'm speaking with...
Eyal Lesmi.
And Manu Ayun.
Oh my gosh. So it's been a while for Android Dialogues, but I'm super excited to be back. And I am even more excited to be speaking with two amazing people in the Android community. Marion, Eyal, could you tell us a little bit about, let's just start the traditional way. Where are you based and how did you get started in Android?
So I will start because Marion asked me to start. So I'm based in Paris in France, I started Android. Actually, you can if you follow the YouTube channel, you should know already. I'm talking to the audience right now.
I like
because
that.
I told that already. No, I started as an intern 2 weeks after the Cupcake SDK went out. That was at an internet provider in France. And I loved it. And I just never stopped since then, I will say.
Well, yeah, I think we all love Android.
Definitely.
I'm an Android developer working at Dashlane right now. I started to work with Android, I would say, like in 2012. I was still a student at the time. And actually, Eyal and some other people were organizing Android events in my engineering school. And at the time, I was already in an association, and I just love it. I love the community, the spirit, and everything. And I also had the G1. I don't know if if people remember the G1, but it was this like huge fun. tuk-tuks, and I love it. So I kind of stick with Android since then.
What people may not know, although you should, is that actually just this week, sorry, it's been a long week, just this week was Android Makers, which is an event that both Marion and Eyal are involved with. You know, with the situation as it is, obviously this is a remote interview, but for those of us in developer communities like the Android community, it also means that meetups, conferences, and other kind of events are impacted. And so we're all trying to figure out what to do. My answer is easy. I wanted to start doing Android Dialogues again, so I get to Skype call Eyal and Marion. But if you're actually doing something a little more involved, the answer might be more complicated. Before we get into all that, I actually thought it'd be really great if you both could kind of give me a history, like tell the audience what Android Makers is and how it got started.
To be honest, the story goes back way before Android Makers. We've organized 3 editions of the DroidCon Paris. And then after 3, we decided to try something new, you know, on the event a little bit more. We have on some stuff. And that's how Android Makers was born. And we actually talked about it Monday, because we actually have this three edition cycle. We did done 3 DroidCon Paris, 3 Android Makers, and the one on Monday and Tuesday was your fourth one. And as we all know, we went virtual.
The very first edition, we are talking about the Paris Android User Group. It's a non-profit association doing meetups every almost months, let's say, for 10 years now, which is crazy. And the first edition has been co-organized with WIP. They used to be the DroidCon London organizers. And since the second DroidCon Paris, we are working with Be My App. And this is really crucial for this project. Having Be My App and the Paris Android User Group gives the skills of organizing and I would say the legitimacy in terms of content and expertise maybe a little bit for this event and also the spirit, even if Be My App really contributed to it.
I was wondering if you don't mind kind of, I guess, telling the story of maybe how you started to realize things needed to be a little bit different this year, and I guess how you ended up switching to a virtual conference. Because, I mean, to let the audience know, the switchover happened in about a month, and I'm sure other folks out there who are kind of running meetups and running events would love to hear your story and your process.
Should I start? Let's do it. So we work every year with one person from Be My App who is almost full-time dedicated to the project. And then you have the POGS team. We are a little bit less than 20 engineers involved into organizing the project. So we are like a big team, really, to work like almost every day. Mm-hmm. And we were discussing about many, many things that we could do, like moving the event, canceling the event. And there was this idea, but nobody was really believing in it, really. I mean, it was like the last possibility for us. And time spent, you know, we were not really able to decide what we wanted to do, because for us, we didn't have enough information if we have to cancel or to move. Because moving is not a good thing for Paris Android user group for many, many reasons. But mostly that's a date we really love for many reasons, in terms of organization, in terms of speakers, reach, etc. And there is this evening, and John, who's the COO of Be My App, called me after my job and told me, like, you know, Yael, I mean, we need to take a decision right now. So there is this and this, etc., canceling, moving. And you know all this. And there is one thing we should talk about. We have a platform that we developed for a few years. I didn't know that. I mean, and nobody in the team was aware about that. You know, we just finished an event with IBM. There's these features. He told me about the one-to-one feature, the fact that people were able to watch, and there is the chat, etc. So all the things that people already experienced. Maybe we'll describe a little bit more the platform later. And I was like, okay, that's interesting. And then I went to the IBM event and seen that maybe it was possible. And really, like, we needed more information. But at this time, from my point of view, was no way we won't do a virtual event. I mean, everybody was acquired to this ID, I mm-hmm. think.
Yeah.
And then I called Marion this evening, telling her, Marion, I mean, there is something, maybe we will try. Maybe we should just keep this ID and dig into it.
Mm-hmm.
And this evening we called all the rest of the selection committee. And this evening, then I think the evening right after, John did a demo with the whole selection mm-hmm. committee. And at the end of the call, we were like, okay, we need to show that to the rest of the team because we think it's the best solution. And then we did it again, a new round of demo with the whole POGS team, and we decided to go online.
Also, when the lockdown, when actually started to be official, because maybe just to give maybe more more mindset from an organizer point of view, we actually were already have selected of your talk, and we were already reaching to speaker to say, are you available? Do you want to come? And we already have a schedule planned. Yeah. So we were really like, is it okay for you Tuesday morning? It's really, we were ready to just publish your definitely. Schedule.
Yeah.
We already give a lot of energy, I will say.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you go to a different, just to a different step. Usually you have your schedule, it's done, and you start to move to something else.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the time to, let's try, we check with everybody, we start again. It's not something we used
right.
to do. Mm-hmm. But we actually, I think we already in February, we already had start to have some speaker or some other people that asking, what are you going to do? Do you have some process? Do you have what do you want to do actually? At the beginning, we were like, we're going to follow how you say in English, government instruction, just give hand sanitizer, stuff like that.
Yeah,
but we also like started to receive information from people that were in company that have policies that say, you're not moving anymore.
you're staying
where you are. Stay safe. Mm-hmm. And so we were trying to start with them and say, for some of them, we select them on a specific topic that we really, really wanted to promote. So we were like, okay, we need to adjust thing. Mm-hmm. And because organizing an event is actually, it's just that, it's adjust.
Just adapting.
Exactly. So we were like, okay, we should try to actually have some remote speaker. Mm-hmm. So this probably nobody knows, but at some point we were in for some remote speaker it's when way worse.
I think it was one full remote track that we were considering.
Yeah.
So it's one fourth of all the sessions.
I will just also say that I was very lucky to get to speak at Makers. It was funny because I actually couldn't make it at first because of travel. And then Marion was very nice and kind of asked me if I could still speak. I was like, well, I guess I'm not traveling. I just wanted to say from a speaker's perspective, it was great. I mean, obviously, it's different than being in the room with someone. And that's always the best, and hope to get to actually be going to Makers one day for reals. But, you know, everything was like very on point. There was like, we were given emails. We kind of prepped with like kind of bandwidth and like camera and mic tests. I don't think I've ever felt so comfortable with just signing on and joining a call before and just being ready to, you know, work to speak. I still, even though I wasn't in the room with people, I still felt connected because there was a chat and there was like, you know, kind of all this interaction. And so I just want to say that was a big credit to all of you and to also the platform itself for being a really great connector. So, but it was really great. And if I can just like share some numbers, because I know you shared numbers at the end, but you actually had 690 participants, is that right? And then just 25 of you organizing and 70 speakers. I mean, if you look on Twitter and check out all the buzz that happened after Android Makers, you'll see how much people really enjoyed both speaking at and being like part of it. And you had some really interesting technical challenges. I think I saw Nicola and John, the two gentlemen who work on constraint layout. That was an interesting challenge because they were co-presenting, having to coordinate like one talk. Do you have any like kind of stories about kind of those like the dual presentations? That seems like a super challenge.
First, we need to give the credit to all of these multi-speakers sessions to Eduard Marquez. This guy is awesome. Really, I mean, what he's doing is like saving this event.
Yeah.
Technically, because it was not possible on the platform to have several speakers at the same time. And what he did was like more than, filling the hole. He just gave more professional UI and user experience on the whole project. So big, big, big thanks to him. Because he was a little bit tired after today producing shows and sessions all the time. So what was the setup? I mean, the big difficulty with that, first, there is the video and the sound. And the sound. He was using Skype and OBS, which is the traditional software to doing this kind of things. And this was pretty okay. And because with this setup, we have been able to do like the app clinic, where we were four reviewers and also one different developer coming into the session. So dynamically during the session, he was able to do that. And so the number of speakers was okay. The problem is when you want to show keynotes, slides, and you want to remote control them.
Oh,
and he's like, yeah, there is a... we published on the Slack, but I think also on Twitter, the schema of all the what they had to do just to control, I would say, a simple keynote file display on the Edouard's computer. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was a little bit a problem, I would say. But they did it great almost all the time. But sometimes, I think during the first Nicolas Roar and John Hofford session, they had to reboot a computer during the talk.
Just to add, if you're curious, the reason why we use Skype, it's because there is a NDI protocol, something like that. Oh. And you can actually have the stream of every speaker. And so that's why we selected Skype. And and the reason also why we have all this remote control setup, it's because Edouard is really, really, really awesome. And he was like, no, we can't use the share screen feature. It's not cool for the, you know, to remote control the slides. I go next. And also because it will actually compress the share screen. Because if it goes through Skype or anything, and you're saying, no, we'll do better.
Oh, wow.
But that's Edouard. He's really, really, really awesome.
That's awesome. That's a really good tip, too. Actually, it's kind of funny, kind of side note. We're actually recording this on Skype right now. And it is cool how Skype can actually have, like, the different streams of video. So that is a really super good tip in case you all are wondering kind of, like, the technical capabilities or technical options that you have. Is there any other kind of like tips or advice that you think really stand out that helped, you know, you make this happen? I mean, obviously you said you kind of already had the speakers and the schedule. You had already done conference work, like normal conference work, and you were like switching it over. But is there anything in particular for this situation that you would love to share with people, or is there anything that you might have done differently?
Good question. You know, that's pretty fresh in our mind. And there are so many things that we will do differently. First, one thing that could be interesting as an advice. First, thinking about the whole user attendee experience. Because actually, we got this platform, and the first thing that we've done is to measure the limits of it and to use it for what it's good for. And I told about the one-to-one feature, I told about the talk with the chat, etc. But that was not enough to really create what we like in All Rainmakers. I mean, me and maybe my friends, I don't know. It's the spirit and meeting and discussing with people and sharing with the speakers. So for the speakers and the talk, we've done two things. The first is that we added a Slido for each talk. It was very easy for the attendees to just click on a button on a link and then ask their questions. Yeah. So the speaker is free them then to show the Slido UI, which is pretty pretty handy, pretty nice, and pretty clear. It's also administered by one of the Paris 100 user group members, so one of the of our team, so we can just display the good questions and sometimes remove them when it's not relevant, etc.
Right.
So that was one thing. Another thing is to add a simple link for the feedbacks. Already, and I think we use open feedback. I think it's one guy from the GDG communities, right, who developed that.
Yeah, it's Hugo Gress. Hugo Gress.
Yeah, I mean that's. I think it's. I wouldn't surprise if it's not open source, but maybe we can give the link to that. So that was the two tools that we used with the platform for the talks. And the other thing, it seems pretty obvious, but we opened a Slack. And we created channels when people were asking for them. And that was pretty, pretty handy. And the number is completely crazy because what we gave on the closing keynote was the wrong number because Slack doesn't display the good stats at this moment. And actually, we got 14,000 messages in 48 hours. Okay.
That's amazing, though. That's a lot that's so much engagement. Sorry, just to go back. So the platform that you used was by Be My App. Is that possible for other people to access that platform and possibly use it for their events? Or was that something particular with your partnership with them?
Oh, yeah. I can give you an insight. So Johnny is one of the founders of Be My App. And that's our main point of contact for the events since the beginning. I mean, we know each other for 10 years now. He was organizing hackathons years ago. And still now, but that's now it's their business. Okay, that's a company who is its job is to organize hackathons, notably events to developers for developers mainly from them, their clients. Okay, they developed this platform for a while ago, but they released it not that long ago. Mm-hmm. And he told me yesterday that it was like a proof of concept of something that it was not planned for them, but they discovered that a community like us, even if they were part of the organizing of the event, was able to do an event on this platform. So yes, definitely, I think they are thinking about that. It's not, I don't know how much the package is ready to be like, you know, you click and you have your platform. I don't know. Okay. But that's definitely something they are looking for now, because they are convinced that they are not only like big, big, big clients would be interested into this.
Maybe it's something also we didn't really insist on. Your partnership with BMAP is something quite unique. They usually do corporate event, like Eyal said. So really we are like, I don't know how you say it in English, but the community part, working with us in partnership is really something there. It's unique.
Proof of concept. You, I guess we could say y'all were the guinea pigs, I guess, for them to try this thing. Experimental. There we go. Oh, that's good. It'd be like a, you know, like a feature flag almost.
Exactly.
I would love to talk to both of you forever about this. And again, I can't impress on everyone how gratifying it was to be able to do this. I'm not going to cry or anything. It's how gratifying it was to be part of this event with you all, especially given how the world is right now. It was, you know, it was a very bright point to be able to be with those people. I wanted to close out by asking, what was your favorite part about doing Makers this year?
First of all, I would have to say thank you to a lot of members of your team. But I think it's me that we will have the opportunity to still check up, still see, because, you know, Android Makers is for us when you organize it. It's like it's an annual meeting. Mm-hmm. And you can say to all your friends, you can say hi. It's wonderful. And when we went virtual, it was more like, we will do it because we think it will be good for your community. Mm-hmm. But we know it will be quite a rush. And actually, it's on the Slack. We had this channel, this intro channel where everybody say hi. And I saw someone that I usually don't see. We say hi at Android Makers. Mm-hmm. And we just say hi, and he's not in France anymore. But it was like, I just realized that, yes, we still add your annual hi. It was awesome. I think it hit me just at this moment. Even this will still have some connection. And that's only a rush.
The main and most, I mean, I have two main and fundamental things that I was thinking when the event was finished. Mm-hmm. The first one is that, I'm doing like a coming out right now. I mean, the Paris Android User Group organizers are crazy, and I love these people. I must tell that, because what the team did, I mean, we all have life. We almost all are engineers, also, you know, developers, and what they did, and I've seen the team working, and I mean the spirit and everything was here, and we did it. This is, I mean, the main thing that I was thinking about when the event was finished. And thanks a lot, like Marion said, to them, because I mean we are 20, but we needed to be 20 to crack this in one
and
month.
To be honest, I think I can think of at least 6 other persons that if they weren't there, it may not have been happening.
Definitely.
Really. it's crazy. Everybody gave a lot, and it
a lot. So that was my first point. The second one Is also the same thing, but for the people, the attendees. I mean, we discovered from all the feedback we got from international speakers like you, notably, but many others, Nicola and John from Google, etc. They know they go to a lot of conferences, and we're very happy. Like every year, we used to have Romain Guy and Chet because they told us that they like this event, and this is like great to have this. And when you ask to the speakers, but because that's what we do usually, why do you like this event? I mean, yeah, of course, that's an event. We know that we put our hearts in that, but why do you like that so much? And they told because the people there. And what I'm happy and I'm a lot grateful for is that the Android Maker community was still there. They follow the ID. And something we said during the closing keynote, we lose only 20% of the tickets from the physical event. We lose only 20% of them, which is like very, very, very small. And another big thank you to the Android Makers attendees because you are making this event for real. We organize this, but it's still your event, and that's exactly the way we design and think about this event. And that's the end for my second point. I have a very last one. We used to have Romain Guy and Chet every year, but we still have this year a little cameo from Chet, who joined the Slack of the event after the end of the event, asking for when the event should start. Aww. So I'm very happy for this because we still have Chet this year.
Let me go ahead and ask you, if people wanted to find you on the internet, how can they do that?
You can find me on Twitter. My handle is Loutry. I have no idea how I must pronounce it in English, so I will just give it a link.
Yeah, we'll put, hold on. I don't know where it would be. We'll put a link somewhere. Usually when we're in the room together, I can just go like this and it's like kind of about the right spot. So I'm not sure where it's going to go yet. So somewhere we'll have that up.
You can find me on Twitter and there is the handle right here.
Right, there you go.
That's me.
All right, now I know where to put things when I edit. Well, I know this went a little bit longer than I had promised, but really, thank you so much for sharing your experiences. Thank you for all your hard work. And if you're watching, thank you for coming back and being with us, especially kind of in these times. It's really great to have the Android community and still, be together the best way we can. But anyway, thank you all so much, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you, Yuen. Goodbye. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, merci beaucoup.
Merci à toi.